I don't love the term toxic positivity because it's such a, I seem to be labeling other people. I'm never labeling myself.
Oh yeah,
I'm
tell
labeling
me more
other
about
people.
That.
Right?
Yeah.
Very few people go, I'm being toxically positive.
Welcome to the Lisa Show, where we take a good look at life. Hey, it's Lisa. This is the Lisa Show. And I just want to say publicly that my hydrangeas are dead. And I really tried. I even was like holding out hope that I could revive them before the end of the summer. Like that was going to happen if I deadheaded them. It's not the case. If you know what I'm doing wrong, I will take all the help I can get. They're gone. By the way, speaking of plants and comical failure, I just want to highlight Joe, who commented on Facebook about the What About Bob dinner table video. She said, I tried a from-scratch pea soup recipe and served it proudly to my family when my then six-year-old lamented, Mama, how could you do this to us? You know, I've heard those words, and I am so sorry, and you tried so hard, and you should get credit for it, so thank you for sharing. Okay, diving in. I've got Hank Smith here today, an expert on relationships who also literally wrote the book on happiness.
It sold dozens of copies, mostly to my mother, but I learned a lot.
I love it. I got a copy.
You got a copy?
Yes.
Yeah, you can go to your local thrift store and it might be there or it might be holding someone's, you know, laptop up.
That's always a good thing when you've, like, for me, you know, made a movie with my friends and stuff. And when you see it in the bargain bin at the thrift store, it's different, doesn't it? You're like, wow.
I have my own shelf over there. This is wonderful.
That book, by the way, is Be Happy. I brought Hank in because he has some of the most concrete and science-based advice I've ever heard on how to truly be happy. People all over the country bring him in to speak on this. And if you're looking for action items to immediately improve your happiness, well, Hank is your guy. And you're going to hear a lot of his tips in this episode, as well as a breakdown of the three levels of happiness. It's cool stuff. And it's especially cool because a lot of us have gotten some mixed messages about what it takes to be happy. Like, here's one example. Maybe you've heard about the smile study, the claim that physically smiling releases chemicals in your brain or tricks it into thinking it's happy. I grew up hearing that, and it's been around. And as it turns out, that study wasn't really great science, and researchers have struggled to replicate the results. But the idea informed a whole generation of coping methods. Fake it till you make it. Keep your chin up. Never let them see you sweat. Turn your frown upside down. And I do have to say that I'm not quite ready to let go of that. I've seen a lot of benefits from focusing on the positive or choosing to have a good attitude, whatever. I think that there is something to that. But at the same time, I think everyone at some point or another has seen how this can go wrong. Like when somebody tells you to look on the bright side and invalidates your feelings, you know, toxic positivity. It's well-intentioned, still misguided. And today's common knowledge seems to be a lot more about holding space for your feelings, being present, acknowledging negative feelings and sitting with them. And I believe that too. It's honestly a little confusing. Do those ideas contradict each other? Some of this, as Hank explained, is because psychology has been evolving and getting better, but it takes a while for the latest and greatest information to become common knowledge.
We'll back up a little bit. Psychology was centered on finding out what's wrong with you for hundred years. A guy named Martin Seligman comes along, late 90s, early 2000s, and starts talking about this term positive psychology, which is, yes, there's some things wrong with you, and we can talk about those. But let's look at what's right with you and see if we can amplify that. So we don't just look at how terrible your parents were, but let's look at the good things that are in your life right now and try to amplify those. Mm-hmm. And I'm positive about positive psychology. I am sure that 50, 60 years from now, they'll look back and say that Seligman was like Freud.
Oh, Freud, the father of psychoanalysis and the Freudian slip, where you say one thing and mean your mother. For everything that Freud did for this field, it's not hard to find things that he was blatantly wrong about, especially about women. That's a tangent for another day. Fast forward, Hank's going to get us up to speed on the very best of what we know now about happiness and Seligman's positive psychology.
He talked about something that really resonates with people when I share it with them, and that is, he says there's three levels of human happiness. One we start out with when we're young, and that's pleasure. Happiness and pleasure are a lot alike. And that's when you think as a kid, it was all about, you know, candy, you know, sometimes new clothes, sometimes the new show, the new movie, it's pleasure. And pleasure is a form of happiness. It's great. Yeah. He said, as people age and they become adults, normally, not all of them, some are stuck in the pleasure zone, but normally they move into the idea of engagement, which is, I have some natural gifts, things that fill me with energy, and I get to use those on a daily, weekly basis. So now I still have pleasure in life. I still buy a new pair of shoes, or I like that smell of a new car, you know, the pleasure. Mm-hmm. And I realize that pleasure is pretty fleeting. Mm-hmm. It lasts and then goes away real quick. Well, like smoke, like, wow, it's gone. Where engagement has longer lasting effects. So I get into my adult life and now I have both pleasure and engagement and I'm happier.
Yeah.
Then he said, all of us get to the point where, at some point, it depends on, you know, it changes for everyone age-wise, but we get to higher purpose. Higher purpose is, I'm engaged in a cause that's going to outlive me. I'm giving my gifts, my engagement, to something bigger than me. And a very healthy, happy adult is someone who has all three. They have pleasure, they have engagement, and they have higher purpose.
Hard stop right there. This is such a cool framework. Happy people have all three types of happiness, pleasure, engagement, and a higher purpose or meaning. And Hank is going to drill down into some of these and how you can boost any one category. But he also pointed out that when one of these is missing or out of balance, people can be unhappy even when life is good. And it's not just adults.
So if you look across your life, I've seen it with people saying, I don't know why my children are unhappy. I give them all that they
need,
and want. I take them on vacation, right? Why? Mm-hmm. How can they be unhappy? Well, they might have that pleasure component, but let's look at their engagement. Are they using their gifts in every day or every week? It doesn't have to be constant. That's going to have significant impact on the way you feel. I like to teach. I feel like I have some natural gifts for speaking and teaching. So I made that part of my daily and weekly life. Doesn't mean I'm doing it every single day. Sometimes I'm in meetings that's not my gift. So maybe my children don't need more pleasure. Maybe they need more engagement.
This is such an interesting point. And what parent hasn't thought about your kids, boy, if you only knew how good you have it, right? It feels good to give our kids everything we wish we could have had, and then frustrating or just painful if they don't feel the happiness we wanted them to feel. But to Hank's point, the stuff we buy, the outings we take, the treats, the comfort, all of that feel good is only one third of their happiness, and maybe even less. Zooming out for a moment, not talking about kids, it makes sense that material things don't make you happy. We got that. And we've talked on the show about other false substitutes, like how social media lights up your brain, but it doesn't make you feel more connected, and even the opposite, and so you keep scrolling. Put in this framework, it all makes sense. Things that make you feel good in the short term, pleasure, are a piece of happiness, but only one piece. And when the other two pieces are missing, you can get stuck in a loop of chasing pleasure and never feeling like it's enough. Before we move on to the second level, there was one thing in this category that I wanted to highlight, a critical science-based tip that fits in this category, and that's get outside.
There's something about nature that's healing. I always laugh at these studies. There was one study where people recovering from surgery were put in a room that the window faced a brick wall.
Oh,
I know, so sad. And then another one where the window, just the window, overlooked like a park.
Okay.
That was it. And
that's
the people in the brick wall room were in the hospital longer, needed more medication, had more complications.
Oh, wow.
And just that. So how I want to take someone and put them in a park every day, right? Set their little hospital bed out there.
You live here now.
Yeah. So, and kids need time.
Yeah.
Kids need time outside. Teenagers need time outside. And it's different than it was when I was a kid. When I was a kid, you'd ride your bike all day.
See ya later.
Your parents be home before the streetlights come on, right?
Yep. Check
and
in.
Now it's a different world. My kids get a half mile away and their shock collar goes off. Like, get back to the house.
It seems that way, doesn't it?
Turn on the TV. So
this doesn't feel right.
Yeah. So if you can make time to say, we're gonna eat outside today. We're gonna go to the park and just spend 45 minutes at the park. Again, it's got to be done consistently over time. Not a big deal. Just make it part of your habits.
Yeah.
Huge.
All right, got that? Happy people get outside every day. It's worth prioritizing. It will make you feel good, and the benefits are long-term. So now let's move on to engagement, that second level of happiness. Hank says the trick here is finding your gifts and putting them to work, something he's seen again and again throughout his career as he coaches and teaches people to be happy.
Sometimes they're stay-at-home moms whose gifts aren't with children. They want to be with their children. They want to give that time to them, but they need to find a way for that engagement where they're using their gifts. Some moms, it's all their children. Child rearing is one of their gifts. So they're engaged in it and they love it. But there's other moms, that's not central to their, to their gifts. And they think, I'm selfish if I go out and do it. No, you're not. Go do those things which will engage you. Fathers as well. Let's say I have an employment that I don't really love, but it is what it is.
Right.
Right. This is the job I have. I'm providing for my family, even a mom, right? I'm providing for my family. This is what I'm doing. Well, how can we get you to maybe not in your employment to use your gifts every day, but in some other ways? I talked to a grocery store clerk once who said, I love people and I just am a grocery store clerk. I was like, wait, don't you see people? Well, yeah. I'm like, well, start using your gifts.
Yeah.
And she said she started talking to people. What's your name? How are things? Right? What are you doing? When's your birthday? Right? Just anything. Pretty soon, she's getting repeat customers.
Oh, that want to go through her line.
Line is long. People are like, you can come over here. No, thanks. I'm going to wait for Janet's line.
That's amazing.
And she's using her gifts every day.
Go Janet. I want to go through her checkout line. Janet, if you're listening, send me a DM. I will visit you. You're my new cashier now. So that's engagement, the second level of happiness. And it doesn't necessarily depend on your job, but if you can use your gifts at your job or anything that you're doing on a daily basis, you will be happier.
Another thing that I would hope your listeners would get from this is don't chase money, chase wisdom. Chase engagement. Mm-hmm. If you chase engagement, money gets jealous and follows you.
Oh, I like that.
But if you chase money, wisdom does not get jealous. Engagement does not get jealous and won't follow you.
Okay.
So the only way to have both engagement and money is to follow engagement.
One of the things I love about this advice, and which was consistent with a lot of things that Hank said, was that applying it means doing things that are small and routine. Making sure that you're engaged isn't about planning huge projects or uprooting your whole life. It's little things that work best when they're streamlined with your real life. Hank had a word for these little micro methods of increasing happiness.
These others I describe as brushstrokes. So if you look at a beautiful painting, say a Van Gogh, and it's amazing, right? As you step back, you look at it, that is amazing. But then go closer, and what you see is the painting is really just a bunch of individual brushstrokes, which in isolation are not super impressive.
Mm-hmm. I might There's tell you— There's not a you, quick fix.
Yeah, this is doing something over and over and over and over and going, I don't know if it's really helping, and over and over and over. And pretty soon someone says, You seem happier. How are you doing? Oh, wow. Do I? So, yeah, I wish there was a quick fix. I wish there was a medicine or a podcast, although this podcast might be it if there is a quick fix for happiness.
That's the goal.
This is the goal. You need to do nothing else. You don't need friends. You can just listen to this podcast all the time. So let me tell you some of these brushstrokes that though you do them one time, you might say, I think I'm not any happier. I give it some time. Just keep it going. Keep a, you know, make it a habit. Happy people have in-person conversations. That's why you can say, well, I have a really great social circle online. And that's fine. But you do need to have in-person interaction. Yeah. Another one is happy people get enough sleep.
That's a huge thing for me.
It's not huge, like, wow, I'm so happy, but it really has impact. This is where your brain is healing and resetting. Now, it's different for everyone how much sleep you need, but if you're finding yourself really unhappy, this might be something you look at. Say, am I getting healthy sleep? This is a brushstroke.
Right.
It's got to be habit. And after a while, it has an impact that you might not even notice until you have a distance between you and where you started. Another one is music. Happy people will use music to deliberately change their mood. I read one study where they took a random group of people and gave them an hour-long massage every day for 90 days. Like that, okay.
Sign me up for that study.
How do I get to be part of that study? And then they took another random group of people, had them create what they called a happy playlist. Find an hour's worth of music that makes you just feel good, and listen to that for an hour a day, every day. And then, you know, we will pay you for this research study.
I mean, that's the dream, to get paid to create playlists.
Yeah, I could do that.
Right.
And at the end, statistically, it's the music by far. It's
more than the massage.
It reduces anxiety increases happiness.
Really?
Right. It's the music, but it's this tiny little brushstroke. You just need to be deliberate about your music.
Did that surprise you?
Yeah, that was surprising to me because I wasn't very deliberate with my music. I would just, whatever.
Are you now?
Whatever. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, really?
Absolutely. I have my little playlist that I'll put on if I'm, you know, cooking or cleaning or driving.
I always listen to music when, I don't know, just, I like to have it in the background.
Yeah. Me too.
Like the soundtrack of my life, if you will.
The drama.
Right.
I wish music came with it, or I wish life came with a soundtrack.
I do too.
And I also think something that we scary should regular, was about to happen.
Right? And you know how you were supposed to feel in any social situation? But I also really wish that we could just break out into song when we feel too much.
Whenever we feel
just like
really
a musical.
Good. Another one would be happy people in general have something on the calendar that they're looking forward to.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah, it's very simple.
It's easy.
And it doesn't
like
have to be huge.
Like a trip or something?
Yeah, it doesn't have to be a trip to Paris, right? It can be a trip to, you know, somewhere 2 hours away. We're going to go there.
Oh,
we're going to look around. We're going to see what that town's like. And, you know,
I don't know why I just went to a trip, but I guess there's other things.
It can be lunch with friends.
Yeah.
It can be a weekend. It can be anything that you are looking forward to because the brain processes anticipation and experience differently. So the anticipation of an event really, really has impact on your brain, just having it out there. I'm convinced that's why people have that big letdown after Christmas and New Year's.
Oh, yeah.
Because they've been looking forward to this, you know, these things for so long, and now, oh.
It's over.
It's over. We'll have to wait 364 days, whatever. But really, it's what's next on the calendar. Put something 3 weeks into January, you'll find yourself not having that letdown.
Jumping in here, Hank's not saying don't do Christmas. What he is saying is that if the big holidays are the only thing on your calendar that you look forward to, then they're inevitably going to let you down because a year is a long time to wait. But if you plan more things to look forward to, you're going to get more satisfaction out of all of them.
People will frequently say the anticipation for the vacation was better than the vacation. That's because the brain processes that kind of thing differently. But again, it's deliberate and steady.
Intentional.
Yeah, you're looking out saying, you know, if you're married, you might say, okay, every quarter we're going to go on a little one-night, two-night getaway. And you'll just put that out, 90 days, whatever it is. It doesn't, I know one of my friends who says we're going to try to visit the towns in our state. and we're going to try to do what they do in that town.
That's so original.
Right? So they go to this local town and they maybe look it up online. What's the hangout spot in that town? So he said, I went to this city and got a buffalo burger because that's what they do. That's what they're known for, right? And we went to this city and we watched some softball games because that's their thing.
Oh,
the city has softball games. And these aren't expensive long trips.
No.
It's right around them. It's within an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours around them. They find a little hotel there and say, what does this town do?
You can just make up anything. That's
really
great. You can.
Yeah.
I love this because it's accessible to anybody.
Yeah. And kids, this really has impact on kids. When you say, hey, we're all getting together. You're going to see your cousins. Have you ever seen that? Well, you're going to see your cousins in this week. In 4 months, and they frequently ask about it.
Yeah.
When is that again? When
but then you're creating that anticipation and for them.
Yeah, and you just keep it going.
Yeah.
Keep it going.
Keep it going. Keep making brush strokes. I think what I love most about these little happiness boosters, listening to music, planning something to look forward to, having in-person conversations. You can do any of these when you're sad. A little earlier, we were talking about that mixed message about what's going to make you feel better or feel good. Do you lean into the hard emotions or do you tell yourself to adjust your attitude? At what point does trying to manage your well-being cross into toxic positivity, that unhelpful impulse which says, oh, you're sad? There's a remedy. Don't be. In talking to Hank about positivity, toxic positivity, and where that line really is, I started to realize that this isn't even just about happiness. This is about what is real. Toxic positivity is denial. It says things aren't that bad. It suggests that you can flip a switch and be happy and ignore whatever pain you're feeling. Healthy positivity, the kind that leads to real happiness, is the opposite of denial. It's acceptance of what's real, including the real hope that things can and will be okay, even if they don't feel okay in the short term.
I don't love the term toxic positivity because it's such a... I seem to be labeling other people. I'm never labeling myself.
Oh, yeah.
I'm
Tell
labeling
me more
other
about
people.
That.
Right?
Yeah.
Very few people go, I'm being toxically positive.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But like going through a hard time, though, and trying to find the good in it. How do you feel about that?
I think you can change your lens to where it's not trying to find the good in it. I just naturally do.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see the difference? It's become the way I look at life.
You just see it. It is.
Someone might be like, wow, you're being really positive about this situation. And that didn't occur to you because it's just
the way you see it.
Just the way you think. Your heart is open and your eyes are open. So you're like, yeah, I can see that this is really hard. And I acknowledge that this thing is killing me. But my heart is wide open to the idea. So maybe toxic positivity would be my eyes are closed to the reality of what this is doing to me.
Oh, yeah. I think that's
probably
an
not
interesting
the way to go.
Distinction. Yeah.
Yeah. My eyes are open.
Yeah, I see
I recognize
it.
This is...
It's bad.
This
things
is gonna,
are bad.
Yeah. Things are bad. Things are going to be really hard emotionally, physically, financially. And, not but, and I'm open to the idea that this might have good come out of it.
Yeah.
That the end result might be something even better than what I had thought it was, you know, previously.
Totally. You'll love this. It, like when our friend, my late husband, your friend.
Yeah. Our mutual friend.
In a wheelchair, power chair, can't move, can't talk. And he types out, I feel like George Bailey, the luckiest man in the whole wide world. And I was like, this is me. Really?
Yeah.
For real?
Yeah. No way.
Nobody else looks at you and thinks, I want to be that guy.
If I could live in the dream.
Sorry.
Yeah.
And I remember having this like real conversation, like, do you really feel this way? And he did. And he said, no, I mean, look, I have all these great, this old thing, meaning his deteriorating body. He was like, that's not my fault. Like, I didn't do any. Like, this is just, you know, it is what it is.
It's my path.
Absolutely not blinded by it. Like, I'm not trying to pretend it doesn't exist because I don't have that luxury. It affects everything that I do. But also,
look at how great our friends are. Look how great our family is. Look what how they've showed up for it. Like, that was what he could see. And I thought to myself, or I've thought about that a lot, thinking, was he just trying to do it? And I've landed on that place of, that's just how he got so good at being like, well, I can't do this, but I can still do this.
Yeah.
And I'll just focus on that. And I do think that there is a correlation between happiness and what you focus on.
You can. You can train your brain to accentuate the positive. But it's really difficult to do in the moment of difficulty to say, okay, now
I'm going to learn this
positive.
New.
Yeah.
And I will say, he always did that. It wasn't like he learned his lesson. Boy, he got that disease.
I'm really in a tough spot. Now I'm going to learn to see things
positive.
Now
I will,
It was a skill set he brought into
100%
the difficulty. That's another work of Seligman is that what you focus on, you'll start to notice more. So for an example, I'm sure everyone has gone through something like this. I start looking at a certain type of car that I'm interested in buying. So I start to research about it, and I'm like, do I like the way that looks? Can I see myself in that car? And all of a sudden, I see that car everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
I see it at intersection places. Everyone is buying this car, right?
Like, oh, it's everyone's favorite.
Yeah, it must be trending because I see it everywhere. Well, I didn't end up buying that car, and I haven't seen one in months.
Really? Okay.
Because everyone thought, well, if Hank's not interested... We're not
stocks went down,
either.
Sales were down. Yeah. No, yeah.
I guarantee you, they're still there.
Yeah.
But I had trained my brain to see it and not really, I'm going to see it. I just studied it, right? Like we've been talking about.
Yeah. So even just engaging in the conversation about happiness, thinking about all the different things that you could do, you're saying you're already ahead of the game.
Yeah. Seligman said, if he can get people, because it's hard to do and people don't think it has impact, but if he can get people to keep a gratitude journal, they'll start to see those things. So, for example, you might think, I am really grateful for silverware. Because, man, imagine life without silverware. That'd be hard. Spaghetti, right?
Oh,
and they just say, I'm grateful for silverware. And they'd maybe write it down in their little gratitude journal. And then at the end of the day, they think, what am I grateful for today? What happened today that I was really happy about? So tonight I might write down, I saw my friend Lisa. We had she invited me on the show. I feel so important. And I had a lot of fun, right? I write that down. If I do that enough times, and the problem is you can't get people to keep up. It's too easy.
People can't.
I can't do that. That's a waste of time. What happens eventually is you become like Chris, and it's naturally who you are. It's you're not saying this is really bad. How do I pretend to be happy about this? It's you really actually are. Like if we talk to Chris, I guarantee he wouldn't say, actually, I hate everything right now, but I don't want to let anybody in on it.
Yeah. That was me. That was my script.
Do you remember the one time, I remember you telling this story about him doing something, he looks over at you and you're crying.
Yes.
And he says,
I was taking care of him. I was like, I mean, it was so pathetic. I wish I could set the scene really great, but like I'm feeding him in his feeding tube and I'm like wiping up his drool and I'm just looking at this, really amazing man who's just deteriorating, And I start crying. And he asks me later through his adaptive devices, why were you crying? And I'm like, why am I not crying all the time? Why aren't you crying? I was a very loving and caring wife, let me just tell you. And he laughed. And he's like, oh, that? Get over it.
Oh,
like,
that.
Like, you haven't gotten over it. Like, I've had this disease for a long time. Like, and I said, it's just sometimes really sad to think about the realities of this. And he was genuinely surprised.
Yeah, I remember him saying, why are you crying?
Yeah, why are you crying?
Like something
it wasn't
happened?
Like, yeah, he wasn't like teasing me like, what happened? Like, I didn't notice. And I was like, oh, I was crying over you. And I think I know I said something snarky like, oh, let me tell you the story of this really great guy and he's sick and his body is deteriorating and his muscles don't. And he's like, oh, got it. That's me.
That's why you were crying.
That. Yeah. Because he was just thinking, well, if I'm at peace with it, I wish I could give that to you, that you would be happy. But nobody can give that to you. My journey was a little bit more windy than his. But I also had a different
experience.
Yeah. Well, you know.
And that's not to say someone listening should say, oh, what's wrong with me? I'm going through something not as hard as Chris or Lisa, and I'm not doing well.
But that helps no one. I always hear that.
Yeah, the comparison.
Like, I should never complain to you because, or to Chris, and I just think no one wins because—
I used that on you a couple of times.
Oh, yeah.
Right, where I said,
yes,
I can't complain.
No, I had a really wise friend who was going, I mean, she's been through the ringer, and I said— and this was before my thing. And I had said to her, like, oh, I shouldn't complain. And she said, no, don't ever do that because no one wins that game.
Ever.
When you're going through the hardest thing that you've ever gone through, it's the hardest thing. It, you know, again, looking at your own path, it has value. You can't just wish your way out of it.
Because there will always be something, someone
always.
Who you think is worse off than you.
Oh, they I met people within the community of people with ALS and stuff where I was like, oh, can you, like Chris and I would go home and I'd be like, oh, can you imagine if that was our situation or that, you know, and we would cry over them.
Yeah.
And so someone always has it, always.
Yeah. No,
it's
I
a
like
game
what you
that
said.
You, no one wins.
Yeah, no one wins that game. So if there's a listener out there saying, oh, I'm just really, I'm not where I should be, I would love for you, listener, whoever you are, Julie, if there's someone out of Julie, how did he know? I would love for you to not be so judgmental about yourself, not because I'm, oh, Julie, you don't deserve that, but mostly because those judgments have impact on the way you feel about yourself. So what I would like you to do is, oh, what's wrong with me? I'm not as happy as Lisa was. I'm not even a fourth of going through what she went through. I'd maybe knock on wood a little bit and just go, that's judgment. I'm judging myself there. And instead, let's just look at the reality. The reality is you're going through something really, really difficult.
Really hard.
You want to have some more happiness. What can we do? We could probably, let's throw on some music. Let's go for a long walk. Let's call a friend. Mm-hmm. Do some of the things we've talked about today, and over time, it'll be significant. It really will.
I'm so grateful for Hank for sharing these tips. As you can imagine, there's a lot more to this. You should definitely read his book. I mean, we really only scratched the surface on the third level of happiness, but this is a good place to start. I find something really beautiful about the way happiness comes from leaning into reality. In-person conversations do what online relationships can't. Going outside in nature for a few minutes gives you something that being indoors does not. And accepting what is true about your real life and the way it feels, instead of saying, this is how I should feel, or this is what it's supposed to look like, that paves the way for healing and happiness. Toxic positivity is eyes closed, and healthy positivity is eyes wide open. It's comforting. We live in a world where happiness is being pitched constantly. Everyone is selling pleasure. Meanwhile, real happiness is something we're hardwired for, no purchase necessary, in our talents and potential, and in our hunger for a higher purpose. This speaks to something that I truly believe, that there is a designer and that we people were designed to be happy. Happiness isn't a side quest or a side effect in any of this, so we don't have to shy away from putting it first. Happiness is what we were made for.
The Lisa Show is a production of BYU Radio, hosted by Lisa Valentine Clark. This episode was produced by Becca Hurley with help from Michael Combs, with music and post-production by Kit Merrill. Special thanks to our guest, Hank Smith. Hank is the co-host of the Follow Him podcast, available wherever you listen to podcasts. You can find more info on Hank at hanksmith.com or on Instagram at Hank R. Smith. Links will be available in our show notes. If you haven't subscribed to The Lisa Show on YouTube, you can find even more content on our channel, including The Council of Moms, filmed live in our studio. As always, thanks for your messages. We read them all, and thanks for listening.
I've got another podcast to recommend to you from the BYU Radio family of podcasts. It's called The Appleseed, and it's a show filled with stories for you and your family. Each episode features master storytellers sharing all kinds of stories, folk tales, fairy tales, personal and family tales. It's perfect for road trips, bedtime, or really any time that you're looking for something that the whole family can enjoy together. And the stories you'll hear, no doubt, will get your family sharing their own stories with each other. Listen to The Appleseed wherever you get your podcasts.